Very warm welcome to everyone to Hashgrowth Asia 2020. This is perhaps the largest virtual summit focused exclusively on customer engagement, retention, loyalty, and mobile marketing. This is brought to you by MoEngage in partnership with Mixpanel, Branch, and Segment. And my name is Ashwin, and I oversee marketing for MoEngage. I hope everyone is keeping well and staying safe during these crazy times. And it's absolutely great to have you all here. I know we all have really busy schedules and we could be doing 100 different things with our time. So I'm really thrilled that you all have decided to spend your time here. We have a very exciting lineup of speakers and panelists today and tomorrow, and I hope we all can learn from their experience. Before we get started, I want to take a couple of minutes and set some context around Hashgrowth Asia. Basically talk about what is Hashgrowth as a platform and why are we doing this. Now, our customers, MoEngage's customers like Ola, Oyo, Flipkart, Bukalapak, Tokopedia, Zalinga, and more, I mean, they all use MoEngage to improve customer engagement, retention, and loyalty. And marketers and product owners in these brands use our product to understand their customer behavior and engage them with personalized communication across the web, mobile, and email. And because these brands run all their customer engagement campaigns through our platform, we have been very lucky, right? Because we get to observe the sheer scale and the innovative nature of the campaigns that these brands are running. And we felt that these learnings should be shared with the larger community of marketers and product leaders. Because all of us, you know, we are trying hard to engage customers who are becoming more and more demanding with each passing day. And that's why we created Hashgrowth. It's a platform where marketers, product owners, entrepreneurs, they all can listen in to their peers and walk away with specific and actionable insights around customer engagement and retention. We did the first Hashgrowth event last year. In fact, Abhishek, who's going to be in the panel, was one of the speakers back then as well. And since then, we have executed 20 plus Hashgrowth events across the globe, from Ho Chi Minh City in Vietnam to San Francisco in the US. And in fact, for this event, Hashgrowth Asia 2020, we've had more than, I think, 4,000 plus registrations. And this event is spread across 2 days. So you can use the same link to access the session on both the days. We have 4 sessions today and 3 sessions tomorrow. We have 28 speakers from across 7 countries, India, Indonesia, Philippines, Vietnam, Singapore, Malaysia, from some of the most customer-centric brands, you know, such as Bukalapak, Zalingo, Tokopedia, Myntra, MX Player, Mape Mall, One Championship, Oyo, and more. And these expert speakers will be diving deep into topics such as cross-channel customer engagement, personalization, retention, analytics, and more. So you can send in your questions through the Q&A window or the chat window at any point of time. We will answer as many of them as possible during the session. If we can't get to them during the session, we will get back to you after the event. We also have a contest, so please do keep your eyes and ears peeled, and we will be asking a couple of questions after the session is over, and the winner will get a chance to win an Amazon Echo Dot. So once again, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Without further ado, I would like to announce our first session for Hashgrowth Asia. First up, we have a panel session with some very accomplished marketing leaders from some of the top brands in India and Indonesia. We will be discussing specific and actionable strategies that boost customer engagement. The interesting thing about this panel is that all the participants are from very diverse industry segments. We have one from the digital media segment. We have one from online fashion, one from an online marketplace, and there's one from an e-commerce company. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our panelists for the session. Sapna Arora, CMO of OLX India. Abhishek Joshi, Head of Marketing and Business Partnerships at MX Player. Harish Narayanan, CMO at Myntra. And Anugra Madi Honesty, Senior Digital Marketing Manager at Bukalapak. Thank you. Thank you, Harish. Thank you, Sapna, Abhishek, and Anugra. Warm welcome to all of you. Thank you so much for joining us on the panel today. Why don't we do a quick round of introductions? You know, we have a very, you know, mixed group of audience. You know, we have folks from India, we have folks from several countries in Southeast Asia as well. So why don't we sort of do a quick round of introductions? You know, if you could sort of describe your role and the company that you represent, and then we can get started with the fun stuff around app engagement. Sapna, do you want to go first?
Sure. So as Ashwin said, I'm Sapna Arora. I work at OLX. I'm based out of Gurgaon and currently sitting in Delhi, enjoying the nice weather outside. Just enough rain to make the weather pleasant, unlike, you know, we were just discussing what's happening in Mumbai. And I work at OLX. It's an online classified marketplace where we encourage peer-to-peer transactions. And we also have a business component over there where a lot of dealers sign up. So they are our business partners and they take memberships and various value-added services from us. And then they are able to also sell their product via the platform. It's an Aspers-backed company. It's been around in India for 10 years, so much so that many people think that it's an Indian company, but it has an international presence, very strong in Europe, quite strong in Latin America. We have presence in North America as well, but by other names. And we have a strong presence in Indonesia as well, and a few other countries. And very different experience for me. I've been here for about a year and a half. And it's you know, people think of it as an e-commerce platform, but it's not really so, because consumers are directly transacting with each other. And as I said, many Indians think it's an Indian company because it's been advertising for many years. And also a lot of people confuse it with Ola. So that was the introduction from my end.
Thanks, Apna. Welcome, welcome. Anugrah, do you want to go next?
Sure. Thanks, Ashwin. So thank you guys for having me. My name is Anugrah. I'm from Jakarta, Indonesia. I see some folks from Indonesia as well. Selamat siang semuanya. So I'm currently working at Bukalapak as Senior Digital Marketing Manager, basically like handling the end-to-end performance marketing as well as on media. So Bukalapak, if you haven't heard of Bukalapak, Bukalapak is one of the biggest e-commerce and one of the oldest as well in Indonesia. We are mainly focusing more into like institution and also B2C as well. And I think in the last few years, we also working with mom and pop store to create an offline to online ecosystem in Indonesia called Bukalapak Mitra. And I think Bukalapak have been around in Indonesia for more than, for about 10 years already. And we are one of the unicorn in Indonesia. So hopefully I can share a few things about the app engagement and also like what happened in the last few months in Bukalapak, especially during this difficult situation. Thanks, Aswin.
Thanks, Anugrah. Welcome. Abhishek.
Hi guys, my name is Abhishek Joshi. I head marketing and business partnerships, as Ashwin mentioned, at MX Play. My job is very simple. My job is to entertain my audiences through the digital video platform. As long as I'm able to do that, I have done my job well. That's what basically I do. MX Player, I don't know how many of you guys know about MX Player outside India. We launched MX Player in February 2019, and in a year and a half, it is the number one OTT platform in this country. To throw some numbers, we have about 200 million MAU only in India, about 200,000 hours of content, and it is one of the very few award free to use platforms. That's about me. Thank you.
Thanks, Abhishek. Harish.
Hi everyone, very nice to be here. Thanks, Ashwin and Mohingesh, for having me. I'm Harish. I head marketing, brand partnerships, and the in-house creative teams at Mintra. I hope the folks from India know Mintra. For those of you from other countries, Mintra is the biggest online fashion platform in India. So think like Zalora, but in India. We are the biggest platform for anything fashion or fashion related. So fashion, beauty, accessories, you name it, this is the platform to go. So if you ever visit India and if you want to shop for fashion, you know where to go. So before this, I spent over a decade in Singapore with equal time spent in Google, working on YouTube, and then before that in P&G. So that's my career path. I've been a marketer always. And love my time here at Mintra because I get to do brand marketing, performance marketing, loyalty, content, social engagement, you know, the entire gamut of fun that we can have with marketing is what I enjoy to do every day. So looking forward to the discussion and thanks for having me.
Excellent. Thanks, Harish. All right. Excellent. So let's get started. Now, obviously, everyone knows that the last 4 to 5 months has been, I guess, unprecedented, right? So there's been a lot of change. There's been a lot of crazy stuff happening. But how have you sort of seen the customer behavior change in the last 4 to 5 months for each of your, you know, brands, right? And it's a very diverse segment, right? Right from digital media to e-commerce to marketplaces. So any numbers, any anecdotal evidence that you can share on how you have seen some of the customer behavior change in the last 4 to 5 months? Abhishek, do you want to go first? I mean, you had a good problem to solve, yeah?
Yeah, I mean, no, but I will just take a step back. Thanks, Ashwin. It always helps to go first. COVID-19 has done something which no amount of advertising by brands could do, okay? It has made consumers change their preferences. Preferences have never been easy to change, as all of us know, and they are stubborn and often impervious to marketing communication, please, yeah. But the unfortunate pandemic has changed the game faster than what brands could have ever imagined. It is more or less similar to what demonetization jump-started the digital payments mindset in India. I would say it is safe to suggest that COVID-19 might change the way we behave as consumers. The shift to digital has witnessed reluctant spurts from time to time, but this pandemic was the catalyst which online companies and e-com firms would have been praying for. I mean, I wouldn't say e-com firms, but it's a big learning in disguise, and it's a big change. We at MX experienced a similar surge in the numbers. To give you an indication, our DAOs moved up by 5x. And viewers consumed more and more content, which on MX, as you know, is completely free. I mean, we have done campaigns around the pandemic and the situation at hand. For example, we did a campaign called It Can Wait, which basically spoke about everything else can wait, stay at home and be entertained with MX. That was the first campaign we did. In line with the communication, we understood the need of our consumers and responded by launching more than 20 odd shows in the last 4 to 5 months. Because the demand for new content was very high as television was running out of fresh content. We launched the data saver mode, which was an initiative to lessen broadband strain in the country. We launched 3 other campaigns, even though smaller in nature, but relevant to our cohort of audiences. All of this has helped. In fact, it has helped us to grow almost about more than 5x in pure plain numbers.
Wow, okay. So 5x increase in DAUs is just amazing. So
yeah.
So congratulations on that. Sapna, what about you? How have you sort of seen consumer behavior change, right? I mean, you predominantly deal with used goods in a marketplace scenario, right? So how has sort of that changed?
So there has been some very very predictable and very defined change as far as OLX was concerned. I'll tell you what was happening during the lockdown time. It was more of a wait and watch for us. So we were very uneasy, you know, as the entire team at OLX. We were careful about what product changes we could do. We also didn't want to get off track because there was a certain direction which we were already on, and this was a more long-term strategic direction that we had undertaken as far as product and technology was concerned, and we didn't want to get off track. And of course, none of us would knew, how, given the uncertainty, how long the lockdown would last and so on. So what we did during the lockdown time, the consumers could not transact on the brand. Our DAO had really dipped. But we continued the dialogue. We figured out what to talk to the consumers about. Initially, we were very tentative. There were a lot of backlashes happening. I remember having a discussion about looking at various negative backlashes which some of the very big brands also faced. Initially, emotions were very raw. So one had to be careful about what to communicate, be sensitive. We didn't know, how much the damage would be in terms of people's health and lives. So that was I remember as a marketer, I just made sure that our human face was making the decisions rather than just from a business point of view. So we were very sensitive around all of that. But I think as things settled down a bit, a week or 10 days into the lockdown, we figured out we did want to continue our dialogue with the consumer. So I'm also trying to correlate to, what the audience is looking for in terms of what happened in terms of consumer behavior. So initially, while people were tentative, people settled down after a while. They were open to receiving messages about what they could do during lockdown, what could be done with time. So while in Abhishek's case, it was very obvious, there was ample use of an app like MX Player. But for products like and services like ours, there was practically nothing that the consumers could do. They could at best browse, they could create a wish list. So we played around with that. We realized, we thought about what could be relevant for the consumer at that time. We started talking to the consumers on how they could use their time. Since we are a pre-owned goods platform, we started talking about looking around for things in the house which they haven't used for a while. Digging them out, using the time, using it for themselves. Also then towards the second half of the lockdown, we started talking about decluttering. So that became an important message for us. And I think it was also very helpful for the consumer to hear messages around that because they could start planning as to when the lockdown opens, what are the things that they could get rid of. Also another thing that was happening unfortunately around this time was that the people's wallets were getting tighter. So I think people became very conscious of how much money they want to spend. If they had planned for some big ticket item, especially things which people are open to buying pre-owned, people started planning around that. So ultimately when the lockdown did open, we saw a huge surge in our DAUs and, both the listers and on the buy side as well as the sell side, the traffic increased. So I think all the communication that we had done had fallen on the right note. And we've seen the numbers come back. We also have a specific transaction business related to cars. So we have, we facilitate purchase of pre-owned cars. And that has seen a very good impact. People have, two things had happened. People became very conscious of not wanting to travel in public transport. So the demand for used cars went high. And then the second, thing, as I said, there was a pinch on the wallet, so the demand for new cars went down. So both of these factors added together, and we've also seen a surge in our OLX Autos business. So, broadly as far as OLX is concerned, these were two broad outcomes that we saw.
Awesome. And Anugra, what about you in Indonesia? I mean, when we actually look at Moengage data internally, right? So we see this slight difference between how behavior changed in India versus especially in Indonesia. So can you sort of throw a little bit more light on how the consumer behavior or how the consumer sort of reacted to this whole situation over the last 3 to 4 months?
Thank you, Ashwin. So basically in Indonesia, I think the first case happened in March. So I think at the time we have a lot of news going in and out and a lot of different behavior coming to Bukalapak. So what we did is actually, because we put the customer in on top of everything, what we did is to actually starting to research more into the customer behavior. So we see the slight changing in behavior in terms of the goods that they are buying, that they bought. So previously, I think in the previous quarter, in Q4 2019, the customer usually buy electronics, sportswear, and also, for example, a gadget, phone, etc. But I think during the pandemic situation, during this COVID-19 situation, they're more, reducing their spending on online. So basically, they're not only they're not going to buy phone or gadget anymore. They are actually shifting to more into like daily goods. So you can say kitchen stuff, kitchenware, or gardening, or I experienced it myself. I bought a lot of pet food and stuff. So basically what we did during the pandemic is actually to shift the campaign, because like we see the customer behavior changes. So we need to cater campaign to satisfy the customer needs. So at the time we changed our focus on the campaign, because as you know, in Indonesia, we have a big festive season is Ramadan. So basically previously Ramadan will be a big campaign, etc. We want to sell a lot of phone, a lot of gadgets, because the previous year said so. But I think during this year, we are changing the campaign into more into like daily goods, daily stuff, something like that. And also not only from the customer, also from the buyer side, we also do some campaign from the seller side. I think we're working with other e-commerce as well, like Tokopedia, Lazada, Shopee, working with government to create a campaign called Bangga Buatan Indonesia, or Proud to be Made by Indonesia. So basically we are going to, we want to increase the adoption rate, the of the seller that usually selling through all offline, but we are working with them to actually selling more in online, because during this situation, we want to improve their income through the digital economy. So that's what we did. That's what we did, Aswin. And I think we see a good positive feedback from our customer. We see like around 20% growth during this situation. So I think it's a good sign for us to create a campaign that's really on customer centric, instead of like just creating our demand by ourselves, or just just to use our gut instead of the real data.
Got it. And that's very interesting. I think that is something that we have seen as well, where there is a lot more change in the category that people want to purchase. So shifting away from some of the high value categories to, you know, let's say groceries and hygiene and healthcare products. Yes. Hey, thanks, Anugrah. And Harish, you know, I mean, fashion is, you know, obviously it's more discretionary spend, but have you sort of seen any, you know, so how did this sort of affect Myntra? I mean, were there any trends that you saw in the last 3 to 4 months, and how has the situation changed now?
So it's been a fantastic learning journey, is what I would say, right? Obviously, fashion, as you said, and I mean, for people outside of India, you wouldn't know that the government actually shut down all non-essential services, even in e-commerce, in April and almost, you know, half of or part of May. So we had about 2 months where most of our business was not functioning, right? So that was the context of where we were. The most, you know, proud moment for me was how the teams came together to use this time to actually plan for the future. And plan for when we reopen, how do we reopen, what is the right strategy, and so on. So the consumer behavior change that we saw was as expected, that folks were more focused on essentials, even when it comes to fashion. So work from home wear, shorts, t-shirts, kids wear, home furnishing, comfort wear, these, and in India, kurtas, like stuff that you could wear in while you are working from home, they saw a big uptick, right? Once we reopened, things like occasion wear or stuff that you would buy to go to a party, or shoes that you would buy for an occasion, those things went down. So these are very logical, you know, expectation that you would have from a country that is going through a pandemic. What was interesting for us is, and maybe we'll talk about this more when we come to it, we kept our consumers engaged even when we were not selling anything. So through the months of April and May, our DAU was not zero. Our DAU was actually in upwards of 1 million. People are coming to the app to just browse, to engage with us, to consume our content. And that was a fantastic learning on how we can get to a point where we engage audiences on an e-commerce platform when we can't sell anything. So that was an interesting journey. The second interesting journey or second phase was immediately after we opened, similar to what Sapna was saying. How do we tell the story in a way that is not, you know, that is very sensitive to the consumer sentiment at that point in time? So we had to say things in a way that is not overtly about just about sale, but also about us serving the customer as they want us to serve. And phase three, the bigger big bang coming back to business happened in June, which was when we run our usual end of reason sale. So we run two of them in a year, which was June and December. And this June, we took a call to not change it at all in terms of timing. So when the entire industry was waiting to see, you know, thinking whether we should do a big sale or not, we went ahead and did the sale. And that was one of the most successful fashion sale events that we have done in this industry and in the country. So that's how the last 4 months have been for us. Initial preparation and strategy and understanding consumer sentiment and keeping our customers engaged even when we were not selling anything. Then a period of cautious and sensitive reopening, and then a period of big bang getting back to business. And all three have been fantastic learnings for the entire team.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Harish. And I see a couple of questions which talk about, you know, how do you handle customer retention in these times and stuff like that. So maybe we can sort of move on to the next part of it, which is really, like how did you sort of respond to these changes, right? So specifically around, let's say, app engagement or customer communication. Can you sort of share any specific campaigns or activities that you ran? Why did you run those campaigns? What was the thinking or the reasoning behind that? And any numbers, to talk about the success of it, or maybe even just anecdotal evidence if you can't talk about numbers.
Sure.
Anything at all that
I'm sure everyone in the audience is attending so many seminars, you know, day in and day out. People are churning out wisdom on all of these things, right? I usually try to leave people with something very simple and something that you can remember, and I'll back it up with examples and anecdotes. The one thing I would say in a pandemic like this, especially when it comes to engagement, is to be helpful to our customers. That's, if you remember one thing from everything that I've said, it's this. As long as we are helpful to our customers in a time when they are going through difficult times, when they are struggling for their business, when they are looking for positivity, if your brand can be that voice of positivity, helpfulness, and making their life a little bit better, then they will engage so much more and they will remember us so much more for what we have to offer. So this was the sentiment that we laid out for the team, right? How can we be helpful across the board to our brand partners, to our consumers, to our suppliers, whoever it is? How can we be the helpful, positive kind of voice in the industry at this point in time? To do that, when we were under lockdown, we did a lot of content-led engagement. So it was about fitness tips, how to get ready for work from home, design ideas on how to set up your home, even exercise tips on what you can do, what apparel to wear when you're doing that exercise. It was very linked with fashion, so it was not like we went and did something else. But we were one of the ones to take that positive approach. So we were one of the earliest ones to launch masks in India on e-commerce. Right? We partnered with Wildcraft, we launched masks. That was very well received. Even after we came down, our relaunch campaign was called Lockdown Stories. So it was about how you are in lockdown, you want to cut your hair or you want to shave your beard, and Myntra is here to help you. Right? We launched, there was a platform that we had planned called Myntra Studio, which was a mini, like a Instagram within the app kind of a thing, right? So it was a content platform for fashion on the Myntra app itself, and it was end-to-end shoppable. So you could open your feed, look at, browse through content. If you like something, you click and you can buy. And that was supposed to launch much later, but the entire team came together and launched it much earlier. So Studio was another example. We revamped our homepage to be more content-led. So last year we had done a fashion reality show called Myntra Fashion Superstar. We brought that into the homepage to make it more engaging. We did masterclass of styling and fashion for our insiders. Myntra Insider is our loyalty program. So we did a lot of loyalty-led engagement for them. So what happened because of all these activities is, the one piece of information I can share is, even before our big end of reason sale event, we were back to our BAU daily active users, right? And that gave us a huge shot in the arm to say that when we actually get into a big sale and we invest in marketing in a big way, our users will return. And the second thing I would call out is the sale itself, right? So the way we activated the sale, the kind of never seen before offers, the kind of brands that were available and the prices that we were offering them to the customer, and going deeper into our tier two, tier three, smaller town markets in India. So all of this made it very possible for us to have a lot of confidence that fashion e-commerce is going to only grow, you know, leaps and bounds in the future. And the engagement led aspect of focusing on content, focusing on being helpful, and reactivating these users. So when we talk about performance marketing, the big sale has a big component of reactivating our users, which means that cohort-based targeting, remarketing, using first-party and third-party data to reactivate these users. So all these things came together. So if you ask me what is the secret sauce, it's not a secret, it's stuff that we know. But doing these, focusing on content that is helpful, putting out the right message, and reactivating the right customers when you have a big proposition like a sale. These things help Myntra to get back to business even better than before.
Awesome, awesome.
And just add to that, I think one thing one has to, you know, be careful about is not to try to hard sell. You know, especially as I mentioned earlier also, at the time when things were very uncertain, I think, you know, trying to shove your brand in and just trying to force fit it is very distasteful, to say the least. And then the second thing is, you know, Harish was talking about what they could do for their consumers. And similarly, one could look at what set of consumers or customers you have and what would their requirements be. So, for example, for OLX, we had the transaction business. A lot of consumers, around more than two-thirds, are now asking for home inspections. So that was something that we didn't, you know, have much of earlier. But we are, you know, happy to offer home inspection now for if somebody wants to sell their car and they don't want to come to the showroom, they can get a home inspection done. Now, on the other hand, many of our dealers were happy to take on the leads that they would get from OLX. They would be happy to take that on offline before the pandemic happened. But now we are, you know, helping them, facilitating the journey as much as can be done online. You know, we are trying to work that out. So that is what worked for OLX as far as, you know, trying to help the consumers and trying to improve retention and trying to keep the consumers coming back was concerned.
Awesome. Awesome. Thank you so much, Harish and Sapna. I think Abhishek, coming to you, I think you had a very interesting use case, right? So for, you know, well, for the others, I think specifically for Harish, Sapna, and even maybe Anugra, it was more about keeping the users engaged, even though they might not be doing a lot of transactions. But in your case, it was more like, hey, I suddenly have these huge number of users, and then you also have to sort of, you know, compete with other OTT players in the market. So you're basically competing with people's time as well, right? For their time. So how do you sort of, I mean, can you share some examples of some of the engagement strategies you ran during this time to keep people hooked onto your platform and retained on your platform?
See, I mean, it might sound all exciting from the outside that, you know, consumers just fell on the laps and, you know, they were ready to lap up everything that we were offering. That is actually not the case. I mean, on hindsight, it might look and sound like the audiences and the viewers were waiting for the pandemic to happen and stay at home and start consuming content. No, that was not the way it happened. What enabled us and what allowed us to do during this time is it allowed us to see things from a different perspective and approach things from a different perspective. For example, entertainment platform, whether it is TV or a digital video platform or a radio, any entertainment platform, after some time starts to take their viewers for granted because they start thinking they know what the viewers want. Okay. It allowed us, the pandemic allowed us to get back to the drawing board and keep a close ear on the ground and start listening to what our viewers want. And this was the first time that has happened that both the brand speak and consumer speak started happening together. While MX Player has the brand positioning of every entertainment, which effectively means every kind of entertainment on one platform, we actually started effectively using that philosophy during these 3-4 months, because this was also a time for education for both as a brand and for our consumers. So the way we approached this was we lived up to our philosophy and brand promise of entertainment. I mean, which is basically communicating what we have and what we can offer in terms of gaming, music, online video streaming, offline video streaming, all of that. What enabled us to turn around at was first us understanding the need of my viewer and then hustling together as a team to address these needs as a brand, which involved everything from the basics of what tools you use, how do you measure engagement, does the definition of engagement and retention hold true and is the same as it was pre-pandemic or pre-COVID. According to us, the definitions itself changed. We were very quick on our feet. I mean, we didn't waste time on deliberating what we should do as strategy and creative and all of that. But having a very close, like Harish was saying, that in these times, you should be cognizant of the fact that you can't hurt your end viewer or your end consumer by pushing something down their throat, which might come back to you and, misfire. So more and more understanding of what they want, offering it to them, and a quick consumer behavior happened. We actually also did a brand lift, not a brand lift, but a brand track study during the last 3 months, because we wanted to know how the brand was perceived. Yes, it's a very good thing when we only see numbers, but we should also understand what the consumers think of us as a brand. I am not sure how many brands undertook a brand tracks research in the last 3-4 months, but we did it, and the results were something that we could learn from.
Got it. Makes sense. But were there any challenges or were there any specific campaigns that you ran to sort of people keep coming back, right?
There were two kinds of campaigns that we ran, effectively offline and online. Online campaign, when I say we ran it on the platform itself, but offline we ran campaigns like It Can Wait, which was effectively, if you guys in India remember, Janta Curfew happened. And we ran a campaign on the same day saying everything else can wait, stay at home, don't venture out. It was a support for the Janta Curfew as a brand. Then when unlock started happening, we did 3 campaigns for unlock 1.0, unlock 2.0, unlock 3.0. I mean, as and when it happened, we also graduated from not directly selling the content viewership, but also supporting in context. On the platform, we did contests, we did watch more, earn more, stuff like this, because it's very important for if there is a 5+X jump in DAO, there could be a -5X drop in DAO after everything goes back to normal as well, right?
True.
So for us to maintain that level, it's a 24/7 job. Yeah, I mean, you have to keep them engaged. You have to keep them offering recommendation engines. What they are watching, where they are watching from, how engrossed they are. Yeah, I mean, it's a always on kind of a campaign in that sense.
Got it. Thanks, Abhishek. And I think, you know, I see a few questions from the audience, and this ties into one of the next questions that I wanted to ask. And I think maybe Anugrah, we can start with you on that. So it's obvious that you know, that every one of you sort of had a similar philosophy from an engagement perspective, right? Which is really towards, hey, helping the users, helping the customers, you know, being more sensitive towards the whole situation. You know, and trying to you know, sort of recommend or give what they were really looking for, which can help in their daily lives and all of that. But what made this, you know, the whole change, right? I mean, we were doing business, or we all were doing business in a certain way before, and then the pandemic hit, and then we all had to sort of change the whole situation. So what sort of enabled this change at Bukalapak? I mean, you know, like, can you walk us through, you know, how the teams came together? How did you collaborate with, let's say, the product teams, the rest of the marketing teams, the growth teams?
Okay, sure, Aswin. So I think in Bukalapak itself, when the pandemic hit in Indonesia, especially in Jakarta, so there is a lot of uncertainty going on. So people starting to assume this thing is going to happen, this thing is going to happen, or that thing is going to happen. So what we need to do as a brand and as a company, so we need to have one single truth of data to tell all of the decision maker or all of the stakeholders that these are the things that are happening right now, and what are the things that needs to be done to satisfy our customer needs, let's say in the next month or in the next few months. So that's basically it. So I think the more important thing is to have the all of the stakeholders, all of the decision maker is having the same point of view that we need as a brand. Like I like what Hari said, that we need to help our customer by providing what they need, right? So actually, yeah, the most important thing. So we need to know about the data first. We need to know like what the customer needs. You can do a research, you can do a behavior analytics in your first party data, or maybe you can see from the external source as well. For example, you can check on Google Trends or any data available out there. So I think this kind of thing that needs to be done before we create a campaign, because otherwise you are going to assume everything before you actually solve the main problem, right? So yeah, so it's happened because I think this kind of thing is happening in the first time in decade or something. So we need to really like creating a new mindset, new point of view about what we need to do in this situation by leveraging the data and having the same point of view for all of the decision makers and all of the stakeholders. That's awesome.
Got it. Thanks, Anugrah. So let's we have a few audience questions. So maybe we can spend the next, you know, few minutes going through some of these audience questions. I think one of the things that that Harish, I mean, one of the questions I guess for Harish is you mentioned about how the entire teams came together, you know, and then sort of how you aligned the rest of the organization or the teams to sort of adapt to these changes. So I think one of the questions is around, hey, how did you manage that? And I think there's one more question which is sort of related to this. It's more around saying, you know, so now that the pandemic is sort of receding, how has your communication strategy changed? You know, is it more focused towards offers now rather than being helpful, or, you know, is it more about, hey, let me sell more versus, versus here's how we can beat the pandemic type? So is there sort of like a change in the communication strategy?
Sure. So I answered the first one on the group. So maybe I'll take the second one. On the first one, it's simple, just making sure that you connect with the team more and set clear priorities so that everybody is focused on fewer things. The biggest complaint or concern we heard from everyone was the boundaries between work and life was getting blurred because everybody was working from home. So just establishing clear guidelines on work norms, like we will take a pause here, we'll work here, we'll not ping each other at midnight, like all these simple things. That plus focusing the teams on one particular outcome, right? So first, before May, it was getting users back to BAU. In June, it was about hitting that sale number. So focusing on fewer, bigger things actually helped us a lot. So to your second question, we still will keep it sensitive. We will still talk about safety, but we can talk more about the role that fashion plays in the everyday life, in the consumer's life today. So it is not just about safety, and it is still being helpful. So that's the brand ethos. So we'll continue to be helpful. But how we be helpful is slightly different. We'll now bring back color into your life. We'll make you more fashionable for your everyday needs, whatever those needs are. See, I noticed the poll that came in the middle, right? So one of the things that the highest scoring one was behavior analytics. I couldn't stress more upon, you know, that. So when we were doing no transactions, my entire team was focused on understanding the customer better. So we did more researches in those 2 months than we did in the last whole year, right? Usage and attitudes, understanding barriers, understanding current sentiment. So we spent a lot of time. And the analytics from a revenue side also helped in understanding which categories were going to perform better, what kind of products are people buying. So all that now goes into my communication, right? So I understand what I need to say, which categories I need to sell, what is the consumer actually looking for, what are they more receptive to. So using the behavioral analytics from a third-party research and first-party data point of view, and building that into the new communication that we want to talk is how we bridge the gap between where we are and where we want.
Awesome. Awesome. Thanks, Harish. And I think there's one more other interesting question, and maybe Anugrah and Sapna, both of you can answer this, because this is more towards the e-commerce part of it. And this is an interesting one, which says that, hey, any particular product changes that has helped you boost your app engagement, right? As far as an e-commerce marketplace, you know, being an e-commerce marketplace, I mean, slightly different categories both of you are in, but I think any product changes that you've done that has actually, you know, helped you guys improve the app engagement.
It's so in a big way. As I mentioned, you know, we have a transaction business as well, and people were hesitant to come out into the, you know, to the stores. We introduced home inspection, so that has been an intervention that we've done. It's more on the offline component. On the online component, we haven't made you know, changes as such, but because it's a pre-owned goods segment, so we, you know, there has been a lot of uptake, you know, just by itself for both on the lister side as well as on the buyer side. So, you know, we haven't had the need to make a change. Had we analyzed something and had we picked up on something specific that there was a need, we would have surely done that. But just by virtue of the fact that it's a product platform which is appealing to people right now, it's actually fulfilling their needs in a time like this. That itself has been helpful as far as OLX is concerned.
Got it. So it's basically introducing a new category within your product itself.
Yeah.
Got it. And what about you, Anugrah? I mean, I think you also mentioned that, hey, you know, there was a lot of interest on some of the essentials and the hygiene category from a product perspective. But any other changes that you guys did from a product perspective which sort of helped boost the app engagement, your DAUs, transactions, MAUs, or your DAU to MAU ratio?
Yeah, I think in order to increase the DAU in Bukalapak, and we noticed the behavior for Indonesian people is they are quite curious about everything. So I think at that time we are partnering with one of the media site company, news site company. So we are putting the news inside Bukalapak app. So we try to boost the hot news every day about the development of the, for example, the cure or any regulation change coming from the government or any new cases about COVID-19. So basically that's about to give more new information to our customer. So in order to keep them going to in our app. And then the other one to increase our transaction is to have a kind of like live streaming shopping. So basically we are creating a lot of shopping experience in, it's kind of like Instagram stories, but in the app. So basically we are working with several brands and also several sellers to actually selling their goods. Like for example, like we are selling clothes or homeware, something like that, and we are putting them in kind of like a live exhibition. So yeah, we are going to create a new engagement stories between Bukalapak and also the customers. So the customer can try to see if they really want to use this kind of homeware or this kind of fashion, what they look like, something like that. So we have a model, we have a setup, stage setup. It's kind of like similar to like kind of TV shopping, but yeah, we do it in our Bukalapak platform. So yeah, so basically like we do a lot of providing a lot of media news, a lot of news about the COVID-19 stories, and also the other part is to create a streaming service in order to boost our transaction.
Got it. Thanks, Anugrah. I think Abhishek, we're just going to take one last question for you, and this was an interesting question. I think this was one of the first ones that came in. I mean, you touched upon the fact about the competition part of it, and how it's not. I mean, in hindsight, it's not so easy, or it's not obvious that people are falling, and I mean, your audience is actually coming onto your platform, and So I think one of the things, and you touched upon this, saying that hey, after the pandemic is over, we don't want those users to be declining, right? So any strategies or any plans around it? So one is obviously on the brand side of things, where you basically said that beyond the pandemic, how do I build the whole MX player as a brand and not just something people, and not just as a utility value during the pandemic, right? So beyond the pandemic, what sort of strategies are you trying to employ to make sure that you don't lose out on all those users that you have gained in the last 3 to 4 months? And this was an interesting one, because I think there was a roundtable as well a couple of months ago, and one of the other OTT players, one of the marketing heads of the other OTT players, also references saying that, hey, once the pandemic is over, one of the biggest challenges that I have is how do I keep the brand rather than just the content or the fresh content attracting the users.
See, in my case, I had read the caution, and trust me, whoever he or she is, MX is not going to shut down. Okay, so don't worry about that. In case you have a job for me, please contact me offline. Having said that, see, MX has moved away only from the OTT play. Okay, MX is a super entertainment app. As I said, maybe it was missed that MX has an offline video playing capability tab. It streams online video. It streams online music. It's a music streaming app as well. And it has a gaming ecosystem inbuilt into the mother app. So to refer to MX as only as an online OTT is a big mistake. So unlike the other OTT that you were referring to, I am not dependent on only one service. I am an entertainment super app. So in that case, for example, during the last 4 months, we launched the gaming ecosystem inside the MX Player app. And right now we have about 200 odd games. What we understood and what is working for us as well is there is an entertainment need for a consumer, right? There is not a video need or a music need or a gaming need. If we are able to cater to the overall entertainment need, then we are home. So if the loyalty of video goes down, for example, I mean it could be a very bad example and out of context, but if, for example, let's assume that the cost of data in this country goes up 2x, right, my video streaming service gets a hit, but my gaming service doesn't take a hit. So it is thought through and executed really well, and hence that's the answer.
So in summary, diversify, folks, don't just depend on video.
In a way, I mean, that's his individual choice of a brand or a platform.
Got it, makes sense. Hey, I think we have pretty much taken most of the time that we had, so there are still a bunch of questions here. What we'll do is we'll collate them, and then we will circulate it with you guys, and then if you guys have some time, to sort of send back those answers over email, we can send it back to the audience who's asked those questions. Unfortunately, some of them have asked as anonymous attendees, so we have no way to you know, send those questions, or answer those questions later on. But hey, thank you, Harish. Thank you, Anugra. Thank you, Abhishek. And thank you, Sapna. It was great having all of you on the panel. Really appreciate all your insights. Thank you so much.